My name is Reverend Naomi Mitchell, and I bring you greetings from the Third Baptist Church of Chicago, where our pastor is the Reverend T.D. Hughes. Thank you so much to each and every one of you friends and visitors and family for joining us on this evening for our Wednesdays at the Well Bible Reflections. We're so excited because our theme this year or this week at the beginning of the year is a new day, a new way, and a new us. Can't you feel a brand new day? I'm thinking of that song from The Wizard of Oz. I keep hearing it in my spirit. And so this theme, a new day, a new way, and a new us, is so timely. And so our Bible passage of reflection tonight is coming from Numbers, the 27th chapter, verses 1 through 11. And I will be sharing it with you from the Message paraphrase. Let us pray. God, how we thank and praise you for this day. This is the day that you have made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. It does feel like a brand new day. We thank you for new opportunities and new mercies every morning, Lord. We thank you for a clean slate on today. And so we pray, oh God, that we would take full advantage of the brand new mercies and the empty slate that you have given us, Lord God, on today. We pray that you will forgive us of our sins and that you would cleanse us from all unrighteousness, Lord God, and that we would take advantage, full advantage of every opportunity, Lord, that you would give us strength, that you would give us courage, that you would give us wisdom, oh God, to do what you call for us to do for such a time as this. We pray, oh God, that you would bless us on tonight, that your spirit would be with us, that you would speak to our hearts, oh God. I pray that you would use me for your glory, oh God, and that you would minister to your people. It's in the mighty and matchless and powerful name of Jesus the Christ that we pray and ask all of these things. Amen. Numbers 27 verses 1 through 11 in the Message paraphrase says, the daughters of Zelophehad showed up. Their father was the son of Hefer, son of Gilead, son of Machir, son of Manasseh, belonging to the clans of Manasseh, son of Joseph. The daughters were Mahla, Noah, Hogla, Milcah, and Tirzah. They came to the entrance of the tent of meeting. They stood before Moses and Eleazar, the priest, and before the leaders and the congregation and said, our father died in the wilderness. He wasn't part of Korah's rebel anti-God gang. He died for his own sins, and he left no sons. But why should our father's name die out from his clan just because he had no sons? So give us an inheritance among our father's relatives. Moses brought the case to God, and God ruled, Zelophehad's daughters are right. Give them land as an inheritance among their father's relatives. Give them their father's inheritance. Then tell the people of Israel, if a man dies and leaves no son, give his inheritance to his daughter. If he has no daughter, give it to his brothers. If he has no brothers, give it to his father's brothers. If his father had no brothers, give it to the nearest relative so that the inheritance stays in the family. This is the standard procedure for the people of Israel as commanded by God through Moses. And the word of the Lord is blessed. Again, our theme is a new day, a new way, and a new us. And if I were to use for a subtopic on today, it would be the year of the woman. She believed she could, so she did. Again, that's the year of the woman. She believed she could, so she did. Corrine Jean Pierre on Move On said, if 1992 was the year of the woman, then 2018 must be the year of accountability. The year 1992 was the first election year to be proclaimed the year of the woman. It was the year after the Anita Hill hearings and the year when an unprecedented number of women ran for office. Illinois Carol Moseley Braun won her race, becoming the first Black woman ever elected to the Senate. Remember that? Along with her, there was a wave of women who took political office. 27 years later, in January 2017, an estimated 4 million women around the world showed up for the Women's March to show that it was time for a change. When political organizing groups announced in October 27 that more than 20,000 women who have never run for office before are now interested in jumping into political races, it was clear that change was in the air. In an off year for national elections, women beat 11 Republican male incumbents in Virginia state level race. Women also broke barriers in culture. Wonder Woman, which was directed by Patty Jenkins and starred Gal Gadot, became the highest grossing superhero origin story film in history, ranking in nearly $1 billion at the box office. And then Burke's Me Too movement, coupled with the flood of sexual assault and harassment allegation against men, brought about a national conversation about power dynamics and inequality in the workplace. Hallelujah. It was clear in 2017 it had kicked off something important. But activists hoped that 2017 was only the beginning. There was evidence that the Me Too movement would carry over in 2018 as companies large and small and political institutions reckon with deeply embedded sexist structures. A recent study found that 43% of men said the news coverage in 2017 of sexual harassment and assault made them reflect on their past interactions with women and whether or not they might have been interpreted as inappropriate. Additionally, more than 70% of people said that they talked about issues of women's equality with friends and family during 2017, compared to only 49% of people surveyed in 2016. People magazine reported that 2018, it did indeed not disappoint. Hollywood actresses wore black to the Golden Globe Awards. I remember that as if it was yesterday, on January 7th in that year. In protest of sexual harassers and at the Screen Actors Guild Awards on January 21st, all of the awards were handed out by women. The momentum also carried over into politics. In the United States, hundreds of women ran for office during that vital national midterm election that ushered in more gender equality in politics than ever before in U.S. history. The Women's March, the official organizing body behind 2017's March on Washington, D.C., held its first rally of 2018 in Nevada in January in an attempt to kick off momentum to get women and Democrats elected in the 2018 midterms. Women's March has created a powerful movement that has ignited thousands of activists and new leaders. Tamika D. Mallory, co-president of Women's March, said in a statement in 2018, "We must turn our work into action ahead of the midterms. This new initiative will address voters' registration and voter suppression head on. We marched for justice in D.C. We created our plan in Detroit, and now we're bringing the power of the polls to Nevada." The momentum on gender equality traveled beyond U.S. borders in 2018. The Canada Prime Minister announced that he would be making gender equality a focus of the G7 meeting in Canada, where leaders from the world's seven wealthiest countries will come to discuss the most pressing issues facing the international community. A record 36 new women won House seats on Tuesday, November 8th, 2018, beating a previous high set in 1992, and 2018 is now declared not just the new year of the woman, but the year of women. Most of these women are replacing men that held these seats before them. They joined 66 female incumbents that we could call this year the year of women. The daughters of Zelophehad exhibited courage when they went to Moses to ask for what was rightfully theirs. They were facing impossible odds, but it is that kind of courage that comes from God. In our text today, it's that kind of courage that we can have when we are assured that God is on our side. These sisters made a decision, was committed to their family and their father's name. Typically, the inheritance of a man would have been given to his sons upon his death or passed down to the men in the family. However, the father, Zelophehad, their father, had no sons, but he had five daughters. Their father died in the wilderness on their way to the promised land of Canaan. Therefore, these women go before the court, so to speak, which included Moses, Eleazar, the priest, and the congregation of men, and stated their case. They were obviously prepared. They knew the law. They were wise women, and they were women of faith. They were courageous, and they were strong women. They demonstrated this by going before the congregation of men and basically asking that the law be changed because it did not include them. They asked for what they wanted, which was the inheritance of their father. Why should they go without and their father or family's name be cut off because of the current laws, which obviously did not consider them, or maybe considered them and excluded them intentionally? Moses went before God, and the Bible says that the Lord agreed with the daughters. God said, "What the daughters are saying is right. Give them property among their relatives." This was the ultimate act of forbearance. Not only did Moses hear their case, he considered their request. He took it before the Lord. The Bible says that God agreed with the women and that the women were right, and they should be granted their father's property. These women, along with the rest of the Israelites, were about to enter into the promised land after roaming around in the wilderness for years and after a whole generation had died off, including their dear father. All that they had been through, from walking through the heat, enduring the long days and nights, the insecurity of not knowing what each day would bring, and for them to go into the promised land and not have any property for which to build upon and create a lasting legacy of their own, or to not receive a portion of the promise, I'm sure had to be unimaginable to them. We can take a page today from the daughters of Zelophehad. These women of strength, courage, and wisdom, they had obviously consulted with their sisters and decided to come together, form a coalition, and gather information, design a plan of confrontation, and act on that plan. They were obviously women of faith because they were not even in the land of promise yet. But they were planning for the promise. Hallelujah. They were preparing for the promise. They were preparing themselves to receive their inheritance. The Lord says to us, be strong and very courageous, to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. And remember that the joy of the Lord is your strength. I would argue that this was one of the first women's marches for equality. These women were marching for justice and allowing their voices to be heard. It required much risk and the need to walk into the unknown. However, when they made up their mind, all of heaven moved on their behalf. We, like the daughters of Zelophehad, have been given a promise of inheritance afforded to us by the awesome sacrifice our elder brother Jesus paid on the cross of Calvary. And why shouldn't we have all that God has for us? As we continue to become disciplined and gain the tools God has for us, let us walk boldly in the name of our Father and go get all that God has promised us to get. You know what? I've made up my mind that I want everything that God has for me. When I die, I don't want anything to be left that God has for me as I'm living here. So I pray for holy boldness. I pray for courage and for strength and for wisdom to go and get what God has for me. We are living in challenging times, and our past administration did everything they could to keep women, people of color, immigrants, other minority groups oppressed. However, the now administration has exemplified diversity and inclusion on all levels, and that display burst forth at the recent inauguration events on January 20th. America was given a vaccine of hope from the deadly virus of racism, hate, white supremacy, division, disease, degradation, and so much more. I'm encouraged that truly this is not only a new administration, but it is truly, as our theme says today, a new day, a new way, and a new us. Listen, I'm not expecting any miracles necessarily from the administration. They are not our savior. But we serve a savior who has given us an inheritance that we should go after. I feel freedom. I feel that because the people came out and voted, because we allowed our voices to be heard, because we decided that it was enough was enough, that change occurred, because we went out and we took action. We devised a plan. People like Stacey Abrams and so many others single-handedly and gathered our people together to come together as one voice so that we could vote, and that we could vote out what wasn't in our best interest and vote in what was for us. And I thank God for allowing all of creation to move on our behalf. And we have seen a miracle in our day, a miracle of people coming together, and what unity, you know, we'll get when we come together as brothers and sisters and do what God has called us to do. So we is stronger than I. There is no telling what women can do when we all come together with our sisters and our brothers and walk boldly with courage, gain wisdom, and stand together in strength. Women, we are life bearers, dream makers, vision casters. We can do what God says that we can do. We can have what God says that we can have. Like the daughters of Zelophehad, many women have paved the way for us. We can check the record to see which women did not stand for status quo. Women who were willing to speak truth to power. Women who shattered glass ceilings. Women who broke down barriers, leaped over walls, and walked through closed doors and received their God-given inheritance. We can be assured that when God says yes and gives you the green light to go, you will encounter roadblocks, barriers, haters, and detractors, but you must continue to push through. Don't give up, and don't lose heart, and don't lose your head. The way is made, because just as in the text, when Moses went to God, God agreed with the women. Woo! Did you hear that? God agreed with the women. He said, God told Moses, the women are right. Not only did they receive their inheritance, but they were able to have change written into legislature. That would not only benefit them, but others that came behind them. God told Moses in verse 8 through 11, then tell the people of Israel, if a man dies and leaves no son, give his inheritance to his daughters. If he has no daughter, give it to his brothers. If he has no brothers, give it to his father's brothers. And if his father had no brothers, give it to the nearest relative so that the inheritance stays in the family. This is the standard procedure for the people of Israel as commanded by God through Moses. Recently, we witnessed the swearing in of the first woman of color ever to hold the office of vice president. How amazing, how exhilarating, how liberating to witness in this our day. Because of the courage of these women that I spoke about earlier, who paved the way for her, and the many women whose shoulders she now stands upon. Fannie Lou Hamer, Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth, and so many others before her. Now she stands on the shoulder as Vice President Kamala Harris is the first woman, first African-American Asian woman to ever go where no others have gone. This is a new day, a new way, and a new us. The glass ceiling has been shattered, and the trail has been blazed. So my question, beloved, to you is, when is there never a time for the woman? This is our time. The time is now, and we must walk into our season when God declared from the beginning, let there be, that was our time. And we must continue to stand our rights on, stand up for our rights, and to stand for justice. The young 22-year-old eloquent poet laureate Amanda Gorman issued a challenge for us on Inauguration Day to step out on faith and dare to go where no one else has gone, and to do what no one else has ever done. Her final charge to us in the piece she so eloquently recited, "The Hill We Climb," which she poured her soul into, echoing the sentiments of our new president, Joe Biden, says, we were issued this challenge, and it says, we will raise the wounded world into a wondrous one. There is always light, if only we're brave enough to see it, if only we're brave enough to be it. Beloved, are you brave enough to see the light? And then are you brave enough to be the light? That's the challenge that we have been issued, just like the daughters of Zelophehad changed the legislation, received their inheritance, changed the narrative, and allowed their father's name to live on. And so, beloved, my question to you, is it a new day for you? Is it a new way of doing things? And is there a new us? Are you participating fully? You have been given an opportunity. And so your obedience, your blessing is contingent upon your obedience. God bless you, beloved. Thank you so much. I'm excited about this new day, this new opportunity, and this new year, and this new way that we have. Thank you for taking the time, spending the time with us on tonight in our Bible reflection, midweek Wednesday at the Well. Join us again next week. We'll be right here on Wednesday at the Well. And do visit us at our website, thirdbaptistchicago.org, and all of our social media handles, Facebook as well as YouTube and Instagram. Thank you so much. God bless you, and have a good evening.